STEMinar lecture series, and I'm so happy to have you all today. We've got a great talk in store with Dr. Yampolskiy, who's our featured speaker. He's a professor of computer engineering and computer science at the UofL Speed School, and he's got a great presentation for you about artificial intelligence. So without further ado, I'm going to let Dr. Yampolskiy take it away.
Thank you. So I give a lot of talks, and I never know what to expect. I don't do much research, I just say yes. So I don't know if I'm going to see 500 people or five, minus lots of organizers and people filming me. So it's always a surprise, but the good thing is I can dynamically adjust what happens here. So since this is not 600 people, we can convert this into this nice, intimate discussion. We can answer your questions, we can get to know each other. It's gonna be great. I expected a lot of young kids, so I kind of filtered out all my sex jokes and all that, but I'm happy to see a lot of more mature adults. This is gonna be awesome for us. Average age is still probably appropriate. Follow me, Twitter, Facebook. Many of you probably already do. If not, do it. I post a lot of free information on this topic. And yeah, at any point, if you have a question, just let me know and I'll gladly answer. So the title for today's presentation is something I didn't select. I usually don't. I send the general future of AI title and then the organizers spice it up. It could be killer robots, it could be this. I'm okay with it, doesn't matter. The talk is the same no matter what the title is. So I'll start by telling you a bit about the state of the art in AI. It's here, we have it. We have self-driving cars, we have smartphones, we have Google, we have all sorts of technology which for the last 50 years has been the area of research for AI scientists. That's exactly what we've been working on. Problem is, as soon as we succeed, as soon as we get there, people stop calling it AI. So things like spell checker. It was an AI project. We succeeded, now it's just software helps you write. It's no longer AI, something else becomes AI. Also, robots are here. We don't have them in this room. I had them in the room last time, so it was really cool. That's the picture from that presentation. But we know how to make them. We make pretty good human-looking robots. You guys follow Boston Dynamics. They just released a video of their latest toy. Looks very impressive. So again, just like with brains, we know how to make bodies. That's the state of the art. The question becomes, what happens next? What's next for us? And I will argue that it's something called superintelligence. Systems better than any human in all domains of activity. Whatever it is, writing papers, driving cars, playing chess, those systems will outperform everyone. Why do I think that? So we're starting to see unprecedented levels of funding, first of all. From governments, European Union, White House, we see billions of dollars, billions would it be, invested in research on reverse engineering human brain, developing human-level equivalent systems. We see corporations with huge budgets get top people working on this problem. So Google, DeepMind, Facebook, all the top companies right now are investing in this. We started to have conferences on the topic, and best of all, we're starting to see progress. We're not quite there yet, but every day there is something which seems to be a step in the right direction. So it'd be very surprising if we never got there. May take longer, I don't make any specific predictions for how long it's gonna take, but there is a good chance we'll get to that point of human level performance and beyond. Other people talk about how long it's gonna take. Ray Kurzweil, who's a director of engineering at Google, has very convincing plots and charts showing computational capacity increasing with time and how that allows us to simulate parts of a human brain, whole brains, all of humanity, and based on that he makes predictions about how soon that's going to happen. He talks about 2023, 2045 as this timeline for getting to human level performance. I trust him, I believe him, it's fine and good. This is completely irrelevant to what I'm going to tell you as the main point of my talk. if it takes 50 years longer, doesn't matter, still the same things apply. Okay, we're good? Questions, comments? No? Excellent. So, hardware is getting faster, performance of supercomputers, I have slides in quantum computers I took out. The point is we're getting to the point where computational capacity is getting to that necessary to simulate human brain. It doesn't mean we'll have software to do it, but at least we'll have capacity to do what a human brain does. And that seems to be a bottleneck. Until we had necessary power, neural networks didn't perform so well. For 50 years, we had the concept of neural networks until we got the necessary compute. We didn't see much progress, but recently deep learning has taken off and seems to be producing very good results. So this is the you are here right now kind of map. We're in a position where we still, in terms of ability of computers, underperform what humans can do, but this is likely to change. We're likely to go into that world where computers can do more than humans in most domains. And I'm gonna kind of try to analyze what happens to us, with us, for us, when that happens. So what are the properties of those systems? Super intelligent computers, by definition, are super smart. We've already seen them outperform humans in many, many narrow domains. So games, chess, poker, very recently. IBM Watson was pretty good in Jeopardy. But all those, of course, are narrow domain victories. The goal is to translate them into multi-domain success, ability to transfer knowledge between multiple domains. An interesting and famous example is Asian game of Go. Anyone here knows how to play Go? I don't know how to play Go. It looks like binary chess to me. What is interesting about the game, in Asian countries, it's like a religion. It's philosophy, it's lifestyle, top Go players are heroes, everyone worships them. In a match between the world champion and AlphaGo, there was two interesting moments. There was one moment where a human made an amazing move. Nobody expected that move, AlphaGo didn't expect that move, AlphaGo lost one game. Why was this a significant point in history? Because it was probably the last time a human will ever win in a game of Go. It will never happen again, even with this guy or some other champion, never again. What happens? Computers get better and better until for like a nanosecond they're at the same level as us, and then we just keep on going, keep on improving. I talked to developers of the system and they say they're still training it, it's still playing against itself. So every day it's getting better. Lisa Dole, the human champion, he'll do some homework, he'll get a little better. He'll never win again. The amazing thing is now humans are learning from computers how to play Go. And they're realizing for 2,000 years, we didn't do it right. The moves were considered optimal or not. The bad strategies we ignored are actually very good. And so there was kind of alternative move 37 to move 78, which was a computer Go move, AlphaGo move, which was against all rules of playing Go. Like if you learn to play Go, your teacher was smacking for it. It was bad. But that was the winning move. And I don't know if you can see it, but basically the outcome was, it spells out die humans here. Not really that much. So we're starting to see this pattern. The systems get to human level performance and quickly exceed it. So intelligence is one thing. Another thing is speed. We all know computers are fast. Faster than humans, that's obvious, very fast at mathematical computations, but there is something called ultra-fast extreme events. Ability of computers to crash the whole economy and bring it back so fast you won't even notice it. So that actually happened. We can lose trillions of dollars and not even realize something's going on. If you can't notice it, you can't really react to it, you can't deal with it. You can later realize you lost all your money, but that's about it. There is also complexity issues. Modern software, modern instruments become so complex, no human can fully understand what's going on with any of those systems. What does that mean? That means you can't switch them off. If you cannot control them, if computer is controlling them, that presents a problem. It's also a problem for testing such systems. A pilot in a modern airplane probably never exercised most of the source code, millions of lines of source code behind the system. The autopilot never been through most of the possible conditions it's flying. So that already has led to some problems, crashes, and it doesn't seem to be getting any better. We frequently talk about possible dangers of surrendering control to machines. We should never do it, it seems like a bad idea. But in fact, we did it. We did it many years ago. Software controls pretty much all of stock market trades, nuclear power plants, military response systems, you name it. We already gave up control. Those systems are not human-level intelligent or super-intelligent, but they are smart enough to control those things. And in most cases, we are not smart enough to disable them, to take over. So that's another property of super-intelligent systems, which makes me somewhat concerned about them. Also, superviruses. I run the cybersecurity lab. We deal a lot with kind of standard computer security issues. But trends in viruses, in terms of impact, in terms of number of computers to impact, in terms of money and damage, keeps increasing almost exponentially. What happens when you add human level social engineering capacity to those viruses? The weakest point in any security system is not the system, it's the human. You make a phone call, you convince them to give you a password. You send them a phishing email, you get access you need. So we're starting to see, using chatbots, using some other techniques, automated attacks, automated identity theft, automated penetration. And that's only gonna get better or worse as this technology improves. Most funding for AI type work comes from the military, whatever it's DARPA, Navy, whoever it is, they're all interested in developing killer robots. They may sell them as rescue robotics or something else for short term, but at the end, those are killer drones, those are automated soldiers capable of very efficiently killing, hunting humans. So that's probably the most advanced AIs we have at the moment. I'll say a few things about positive impact of this technology. Obviously, it wouldn't be fair to completely ignore it. It's going to be the last slide I'll have on positive impacts of that technology. Anything you can do with this automation, whatever it is, automation of physical labor or cognitive labor, produces tremendous impact on the economy. Free labor, trillions of dollars worth of performance. You can start new companies, you can solve a lot of basic needs, hunger and such. We can help automate science, maybe develop unified theories for science. I don't even know some of the things we can come up with. I call them unknown unknowns, things I cannot imagine because I'm not super intelligent. But there is a chance of things being very, very good for us if we do it right. Any questions about that? It's your last chance to say something about positive impacts of AI. No? Okay. So why am I concerned? Because for every single positive, there is an equivalent negative. If you talk about automation of labor, you're really talking about technological unemployment, everyone losing their job. Right now, fast food workers are kind of worried, we're starting to replace them, but this is coming to all of us. I don't care what job you're doing, you will be replaced. You may be the last one to be replaced, but it doesn't matter, it's going to happen to everyone. Interestingly enough, this is a list of my concerns. Complete unemployment is not even the big thing I'm worried about. There are issues with those systems taking control and dominating in all other domains. Political, economic, pretty much everything. And again, this unknown unknowns situation is the main concern. I can't even get ready, prepare myself for possible negative outcomes the system has in store for us. So let's kind of dive deeper into that, analyze the situation. First of all, maybe 5 years ago, maybe a little more, this area of research was kind of like science fiction. Nobody took you seriously and nobody listened to you. A couple years ago, a lot of famous people started paying attention to it and saying things. Used car salesmen, presidents, former presidents, everyone kind of got into this topic, and that had a lot of impact. People started listening, and that was great for me. I was like, hey, I told you so. This is good. So a lot of opportunities became available. I got invited to speak in front of 10 people. This was wonderful. Why are they concerned? What is the main concern they are pointing out? We, as people, at least in universities, tend to brag about identity diversity we have here. We have young people, old people, people of different races, genders, colors. We're very different, right? But really, no, we're almost identical. We are almost the same. We are all human, we have the same DNA, same values, same ideas. We all can be seen as this pale blue dot in the space of miner's eyes. If you think about how different a mind can be from yours, think about animals, think about aliens, think about AIs, evolved or engineered. The space of mind designs is truly infinite. And the chance that whatever minds we produce in those AIs will happen to be in this space are almost zero if we're not explicitly designing them to be in that space. Minds different from ours don't have basic human common sense, something even kids have. And that can be dangerous situations. So this is something I call the singularity paradox. You have those super intelligent machines, they're capable optimizers which will beat you in any domain, but at the same time, they're really dumb. They don't have basic understanding of what it is you want. I can give you a lot of examples. I'll give a few simple ones. You create a super intelligent machine, you start giving it orders. What's the first order you give it? People usually go with something like, make everyone happy. Make all people happy. Sounds very nice. We all immediately understand you want people to be healthy, wealthy, wise, beautiful, all the good things. But there are other ways of making everyone happy. Drugs, kids, try drugs. This is awesome. It works just as well or better. It's obvious to most of us that it's not the solution we had in mind. But it's not obvious to a machine. There are other examples. You can say things like, well, I don't want anyone with cancer out there, you know, no cancer. There are multiple ways to get to that point as well. You see what I'm suggesting? So I started looking at how we can end up in a situation with dangerous AI. And there are quite a few different possibilities. We can screw up in the design stage, we can screw up in implementation of those machines, programming them in. Maybe the system is evolving, self-improving, and takes a wrong turn. That's possible. More recently, I started paying attention to a more obvious problem. What happens if there are bad actors involved? Like hackers today, like terrorists, criminals. Even if you design a very benign, safe system, someone can simply change a few variables in it, misuse it, give it wrong goals. There is absolutely no research on that. No one is looking at that. We published a paper on this topic, and just last week, finally, at Oxford, there was a workshop on bad actors in AI. So we talked about it a little bit. But really, completely underexplored space. So the good news is some people starting to pay attention. There are some books coming out on this topic. Still, a lot of them are kind of pushing all the benefits of AI without any attention to possible problems. But some people starting to pay attention. Probably the best book on the topic is Nick Bostrom's Superintelligence book. Anyone read that? No? OK, good book. Read it. I recommend it. My book, same topic, more computer science-y flavor to it. So I mentioned all the famous people got involved, and that created interest, and better yet, it created funding. Funding resulted in a lot of labs, institutes, starting up at top universities. So now, just in the last 2-3 years, Oxford, Cambridge, MIT, Berkeley, University of Louisville, all have people studying AI safety. How awesome is that? It's a good time to be alive. Just last month, there was a conference with over 100 people, all top scholars from different disciplines, all coming together to try to address this problem, see what we can do about it. So it's becoming serious science. One of the things we did when we started working in this area with a colleague of mine, we wanted to kind of understand what has been done, so we don't repeat the same mistakes, so we gotta move it forward. So we created a survey of pretty much everything we can find on this topic. What did people say about controlling intelligent machines? We found some 300 references. We analyzed them, we classified them, we looked at what they can do, and obviously I don't have time to tell you about all 300 of them. I'll kind of give you some highlights, some very common ideas people immediately shout out if they just hear about the problem. One interesting observation is that some of the earliest work we found was from 1863. Just think about it for a moment. If you're interested, this is available online. Just grab the document, you don't have to pay or anything. So what are the solutions people proposed? First one, do nothing. I have a number of problems with this approach. One is you cannot get funding for it. It's very hard. Second, I don't think it's going to work. The logic is that, maybe we'll fail to create super intelligent machines, so we don't have to worry about it. Maybe they'll be nice to us. Smart people are nice and altruistic, so again, maybe that is not an issue. Not a guarantee to work. What else have people suggested? You guys know who that is? Maybe older? Anyone?
Unabomber.
This is Dr. Kaczynski, Harvard mathematician, also Unabomber. His approach was to take this problem so seriously, he started killing computer scientists. I'm against this approach, I'm a computer scientist. For obvious reason, I don't agree with him, but it makes a good point. Interestingly enough, I got an email a couple months ago from his publisher saying, do you want to get his latest book? Because they publish on this topic, I guess. And I was like, sure, yeah, I'd love to get his latest book. And so a few weeks later, a package arrives from Unabomber. I ordered it, but do I open it? It was an obvious. There are some ideas which are very human-centric. The ideas are, let's integrate them with human society in terms of economics, in terms of law. Just give them a set of rules and they can be just like us, working somewhere, raising families. It seems like this is unlikely to work. We're not sure how to punish robots, how to, you know, prevent them from multiplying unreasonably. So those ideas are unlikely to work in anything other than fiction. Another approach recently championed by Elon Musk is this idea of neural lace or some other augmentation, where we say, okay, so we can't compete with super intelligent machines as we are today. What if we were to upgrade ourselves, improve ourselves to the point of being super intelligent ourselves? I'm not sure this will work in a sense of preserving humanity. We might become very intelligent, we might become more competitive, but if you are now a software upload on a computer, you're no longer, at least in the traditional sense, part of humanity. You're probably closer to AIs and have very different concerns and issues. So in a way, I don't see it as a solution to the problem we had proposed initially. How many of you know about three laws of robotics? You should all know about it. It's the most famous solution to this problem. If there is anything you should remember from my lecture, this is a bad solution. This is not the solution. The laws were designed to sell books. They are literary tools. They are designed to fail. They are self-contradictory, poorly defined. If you read the books, you know what happens every single time. Increasing the number of laws also doesn't help. You can make it 10. It still doesn't work. People tried that. So some of the things I actually work on, solutions which I found to be, if not actual solutions, at least partial solutions, is this idea of software verification. We do it with standard, not intelligent software. We develop mathematical proofs for what software should be doing and if implementation matches initial design. Problem is, nobody knows how to do it for human level intelligent systems in novel domains. How do you verify somebody's behavior? Think about doing it for a human. Can we develop safe humans? So while it seems promising, it's still very much an open area, and there is a lot of work to be done, a lot of additional research to be completed. Another project we have is this idea of, let's call it, putting AI in prison. And the goal is to kind of restrict access of that system to the outside world, to the internet, to people, to be able to study it, to study its behaviors, to understand how it works. If you ever work with computer viruses, you study them on a computer separated from everything else, there you have a computer, and then you can understand better how it works, how it spreads, what the code does, who wrote it. So we developed a protocol, different levels of access in terms of inputs and outputs the system can have, and you can decide if you give it more information, less information, to at least buy us some time. Again, long term, a super intelligent system is very likely to escape. You guys seen Ex Machina movie? Yeah, some of you. So that's the idea. It's a useful tool, but we still need much better solutions, obviously. So I gave you some examples of problems which will not give us a perfect solution to it. I want to kind of place this whole area of research in the context of broader science. We are scientists like freedom. We don't like being told what to do and what not to do, but we still kind of agree that certain things should not be researched. There are some limitations. So things like biological weapons, experiments on humans, even human cloning. We have kind of agreed that maybe we need to slow down, maybe not do it, maybe, you know, develop better safety procedures before proceeding with that. So I'm arguing that advanced intelligence is kind of like this technology in terms of damage it can cause, in terms of how much concern we should have for it. It seems kind of weird to talk about software that way. We're not used to people getting permissions to write software. People just go and write what they want. That's how it's historically been. So then we proposed initially to have review boards, like we do for medical science, for AI, for computer science. That was quite unorthodox, very unusual at the time. I'm happy to say that by now, we actually seen companies like Google DeepMind, Lucid AI, AGI, all implement AI safety boards, review boards for software. So it seems to be growing in popularity. So the idea is exactly what we do with kind of institutional review boards, medical review boards. You have an idea, you have a project, somebody else should take a look and decide, well, what is the chance that you're going to succeed completely with this in a month? And if so, do you have a safety plan? So there are obviously two different types of work we do it. There is narrow AI work, simple systems which don't have ability to self-improve, learn, transfer knowledge, which will never become anything other than experts in that domain. So again, spell checker is a great example. And then there is research people do on those multi-domain self-improving systems, and those have potential of surpassing expectations. And that's where I would suggest this type of institutional review board would be very helpful. So of course it's not always easy to tell whether a project is just AI, narrow AI, or general AI. You're studying neural networks. If you put enough of them together, does this become now kind of generalized simulation of human brain? So that in itself is an open problem. But it seems like a good idea if you have sufficient resources and a lot of people working on it, you're seeing a lot of progress, maybe get a second opinion before you push that button. Just an idea. So I'll summarize by showing you this list. This is kind of an outline of different ways standard narrow AIs have failed historically. I don't know, can you see what's on it? There are links to papers I'll share with you which have all the data. But basically what we observe, whatever AI you design will fail very likely soon at exactly what you designed it to do. Your autocorrect will give you wrong words, your self-driving car will crash, your whatever it is you designed to X will fail to X. And as we have more and more AIs, we can see this exponential trend of all of them failing more and more. As we have more of them available, this is becoming a problem. As we give them more control, more power, and more ability, the failures will become more common, more impactful. When a narrow AI system fails, this is like a problem with cybersecurity. Okay, somebody broke the system, now you have to reset your password, maybe your credit card is vandalized, but you can kind of undo this damage. If a general AI fails, there is no undo button. At this point, you basically have to deal with whatever damage it caused and whatever resources you lost in the process. So a few predictions, we'll see this process continue for the next couple of years. We'll see more and more failed AI projects, not in a commercial sense failed, but in terms of AI system failing to perform as expected. And we definitely need more people to participate in trying to steer design of those systems towards a safer future. People who understand the problem and have safety in mind by design. If you are not thinking about AI safety while you're working on those systems, you'll end up in the same situation as people working on Internet of Things right now. They developed this technology without ever considering security. So we have billions of devices on the internet with no security attached to them. That's a problem. When they become intelligent, it's a bigger problem. So that's kind of main conclusions. I'll save more for discussion. If you want to read more and learn more, I have all the papers on my website. Just Google my name. Free, very readable. If you want, I spread the flyer with the book. People like the book. Amazon likes it. Buy the book. Questions? Let's make it a discussion. Yes?
Hi.
Hi.
So I have a couple of questions. First of all, I was just wondering, what do you specifically do with UofL on this research?
Like this research specifically?
Yeah.
So as I said, we started by creating the field. When I started, there was no AI safety work. So we surveyed what people considered before. We started looking at how the problem can happen. We started looking at, well, what tools do we need to do this research? So kind of the slides on surveying, taxonomy of pathways to dangerous AI, and then boxing and verification tools. Right now, as I said, I'm kind of switching more towards malevolent AI, how people can use those systems in negative ways on purpose to cause maximum damage, and is there anything we can do for it? There is not a one way to do this work. I kind of concentrate personally on long-term, so super intelligent systems. A lot of people look at AI safety in the next 5 years. So how do you make sure those systems, for example, are not biased? Standard problems, racism, sexism. How do you make sure the systems are not hackable? So you can decide. This could be very mathematical. There are people who publish proofs. Okay, a self-verifying system will never change its utility function. Mathematical proof. There are people who talk about policy. UN should do this and that to prevent militarized AI. So it's really up to you how to proceed.
My other question was, it seems like the longer this field has been around, the further the threshold is kind of pushed back for what is acceptable, what is like okay in society. For what a machine can do. How do you think that momentum that's been built up can at some point taper off so that?
Not really. I mean, the systems become more and more human. We're already starting to see, and I promise not to make sex jokes in front of kids, but we're starting to see sex robots, right? We're starting to talk about robot rape and things like that. So boundaries have been destroyed a long time ago. A lot of times you won't be able to tell whether it's a human or not. Okay, let's go sequentially.
All right, so in your opinion, currently, should scientists, researchers, engineers, should they be focusing more on developing the intelligence of robots, or should they be start hesitating more on, should they start considering more of the negative implications, and should they start hesitating on further developments?
So I'm not supporting anyone stopping work completely, but they should keep this in mind. And nobody knows better the project than the person working on it. If there is no way this is going anywhere, yeah, go ahead. But if you think you're like 5 minutes away from success, definitely slow down. It's not worth it, because the commercial success you'll get versus damage you can possibly cause. Look at something like Tesla, right? So they don't have a proven self-driving car. They have a prototype which kind of does something. But they decided to release it to millions of people because they need training data. They did a calculation, okay, somebody dies, we pay off $5 million to a family, so the cost of the data is X. Well, let's buy this data set, it's a good idea. Will they be leader in that field? Yeah, absolutely, they have the best data. Google has 1 million miles, after 5 years, they have 1 million miles a day. But it's an ethical consideration you have to make. Yes, sir.
I just wanted to take a specific example where you said we were talking about restricting their input and output, the robots' input and output in society. If we restricted them from the beginning, do you think we would have to keep them that way forever? Because then releasing their non-restriction could lead to resentment for their previous restriction. Do you think if we started them on that, we would have to keep it that way forever?
So I'm not concerned about kind of revengeful AI. They don't have those human emotions, at least unless you program them explicitly to have that. But I'm more concerned that, okay, you studied this AI for 2 years. It seems to be very nice to you and smart and helpful. The moment you release it, it's called a treacherous turn. It turns on you. So it's smart enough to pretend to be nice while it's tight. How would you test if it's pretending? And there is research and tripwires and things to kind of give it a honeypot, see if it takes it something it shouldn't be doing. Basically, it's like raising kids. You put a cookie jar and you say, don't eat the cookies. And then you walk out and it's fine. It's the same thing, same research. Yes, sir.
So when you mentioned about AI is taking over wider and more in-depth portions of our lives. You also mentioned how they're currently integrated with our utilities and our nuclear power plants and so on and so forth. How do you think I'm going to say the uncompatibility of aging technology will kind of affect that as AI and technology becomes more integrated? Because all right, I know our utility system, at least here in the US, is pretty elderly. Most of it was made decades ago, and much of it isn't going to be compatible with technologies we have in a dozen years down the line, at the very least not with the, I'm going to say, super complex stuff we have. How do you think it's going to kind of create a threat?
Can you kind of condense it a little? I kind of lost you in the transition between old technology and new. What is the question?
How do you think the integration of AI is going to kind of interact with the aging hardware and infrastructure that is kind of what we have our current society based on? Because I imagine there's probably going to be some discrepancies between what the software is going to be able to interact with.
Well, if we're building human level performance, if humans can do it, the machine can do it, right? So if it takes a janitor to mop up that old clean room, then that's what it's going to take. You have a robot who can do it potentially. You can always replace those old technologies with much, much more innovative systems. So you can skip old ways of generating energy, go to something nuclear, or is that your question at all?
No.
I'll try again, but let's give it a few minutes. Anyone else? Yes.
I'm going to switch gears a bit. So how did you personally get interested
in my statement of purpose for PhD program, I wrote, I want to be a part of group of people creating beneficial AI. I want to create AI. I got funding through NSF for cybersecurity work, so we looked at behavioral biometrics, recognizing people based on how they talk, how they walk. I looked at how they play games, poker. And one thing at a time, there was a lot of online poker. This was before Bush made it illegal. So poker bots were a huge problem. So I realized I can apply same tools for making systems secure against humans, secure against bots. And that kind of just went, well, as bots become more capable, how can we keep up with that process? So a very natural transition.
Yeah, interesting, thank you.
Sure. Yes?
Okay, so you showed the graph projecting over singularity sometime in the future.
Curves, whiles, exponential curves,
sure.
Yeah.
You also showed a slide of about 100 or so people at that conference. How many of them agree that that's going to happen? Are there other models that have that sort of plateauing off or flapping out of any sort of way?
So very few people say it will not happen. Some people say it will take longer, or much longer, or a really long time. But that's irrelevant. This problem will take more than 5 years, more than 10 years to solve. So if it takes 50 years, it's still just as relevant. There is kind of split in community between people who say, this is the most important problem, drop everything and work on it, and people who say, I don't care about this. This is like 20 years away, who cares? We've seen it with other technologies. If you look at something like global climate change. So we have pretty good data pointing in one direction, but there are people going, you know, it's 1 degree over 100 years. I like when it's warm. Let's call it redistribution of good weather. Problem solved. Yeah?
I've read that a lot of the US infrastructure, like electric and power plants, hydroelectric dams and things, they run on a lot of artificial intelligence. And I've read that, that artificial intelligence is susceptible to hacking. Do you think there's any way to employ counter artificial intelligence to prevent or to deal with damaged or tampered with
Sure, so in cybersecurity right now, that's the hottest area. Everyone uses machine learning to either defend the system or to attack the system. And you start with AI wars, who has better AI to penetrate. And the government pours money, and the Chinese keep up, and the Russians jump in, and you have a war of super intelligent systems. We might be a casualty in that process. Yes?
So when you read sci-fi stories or watch sci-fi movies, there's always this concept of vengeful AI, you know, robots that despise humans for whatever reason. Do you think there's a possibility of humans intentionally programming AI to be vengeful or for some reason to want to exact revenge on this?
Yes, but on purpose, as you said. It will not happen by accident. It's not a natural tendency of systems to become human-like. Mm-hmm. But there are people who will do it for sure. Again,
sure.
We have a list of those agents. We're talking terrorists, religious cults, doomsayers, suicide people, anyone with intention to cause harm.
That's kind of frightening.
Yes.